7 o'clock. Welcome to the regular meeting of the Board of Directors of Coastside County Water District for Tuesday, September 13th, 2016. Joanne, roll call.
Yes, Director Coverdell?
Here.
Vice President Reynolds? Director Feldman?
Here.
President Glassberg?
Here. Please stand and join me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Amen.
This is the time for public comment on items that are not on the agenda. Is there anybody who would like to address the board on an item that is not agendized?
I see public.
Yeah. Hearing none, we will move on to a public hearing to allow community input on Coastside County Water District's Water Shortage Contingency Plan, the Water Conservation Act of 2009, and Urban Water Management Plan. Mr. Dixon, shall we have a staff presentation before public?
Okay. I'll introduce Kathleen Brennan. We also have Elizabeth Dreyer from West Yost, who has contributed a lot to this urban water management plan and to the previous one in 2010. Just to give you some perspective, this is an effort that Kathleen has dedicated a lot of time to, both Kathleen and Elizabeth. The effort began at least 3 years ago, virtually right on the heels of the 2010 urban water management plan. It's involved about $50,000 worth of effort by West Yost, $140,000 worth of effort on our water audit. I don't think we spent all that, but that was the approved budget. $30,000 or so worth of modeling that we did in association with BOSCA, in coordination with BOSCA, and later tweaking the BOSCA-related model on our own. So this urban water management plan, I really have to credit Kathleen's efforts in, both Kathleen and Elizabeth, in understanding the constantly changing and updating requirements of the Department of Water Resources and trying to present this sort of snapshot of where we are now. And as soon as we finish with this, we'll start on the 2020.
Yeah. It's already started.
Right, it's already started. So, but that's by way of introduction. I'll just let Kathleen make her presentation.
I need a bigger thing.
Yeah. Okay.
So, public hearing is open. So, as Dave briefly mentioned, the purpose of this public hearing is to adopt the district's 2015 Urban Water Management Plan. And part of the adoption includes approving an update to the Water Shortage Contingency Plan, which staff brought to the board in March of 2016, and approving the updated urban water use targets, which are part of the Water Conservation Act of 2009. So next slide just shows an image of our legal notice that we put in the Half Moon Bay Review, noticing this public hearing, and for in case anyone from the public was interested and wanted to attend or provide comments, even if they couldn't attend, there was time for them to review the draft plan online and provide any written comments to us for consideration. And we did in the public hearing is noticed all three items that we'll be discussing: the water shortage contingency plan, the urban water use targets, and the urban water management plan as a whole. Okay, so the first item we'll talk about is the water shortage contingency plan. So this is a requirement under the Urban Water Management Planning Act, California Water Code, and it requires agencies to provide water shortage contingency planning and analysis, and to include that analysis in their urban water management plan. The objectives of the water shortage contingency plan include conserving supplies for the greatest public benefit, prioritizing domestic use, sanitation, and fire protection, and minimizing any adverse impacts on economic activity and environmental resources. So our water shortage contingency plan, again, it's going to look familiar. I brought this to the board in March in a public hearing, and it includes 5 stages that are triggered by water supply availability, and it goes from a 0% reduction up to a 50%, 50% shortage, I guess I should say, in stages. And I should remind you that the district is currently in the stage 2 with our, and we have an ordinance in place that has restrictions on irrigation and things like that. And also, I should mention, as the slide says, the full water shortage contingency plan can be found in Appendix J of the plan, and there's descriptions of the plan in Chapter 8. So this is, I call this my mea culpa slide.
What oops mean?
The reason that we're bringing this back to the board is because in my notice in the Half Moon Bay Review back in March, noticing the public hearing, I put the wrong date. I put March 9th instead of March 8th. So it's a procedural error, so it requires us to hold another public hearing. So we're including this for the Urban Water Management public hearing. And in addition to that...
So would that mean that people who wanted to come?
Yeah.
Who there probably were not many.
No, and I actually... I stayed the next night to see if anyone showed, and nobody showed. So I.
And then, legally speaking, procedurally, yes. You have to redo it, even though it's been approved. No, yeah. I didn't participate in that. That's why it was news to me.
So. Yes. So that's why, in case you're wondering, that's the main reason we're bringing it back. But also, we did find an addition error in Table 4 that needed to be corrected. So we're going to. Talk about that in the next slide. So the change to Table 4 that we needed to make was one of the things we have to do is estimate water supplies during specific scenarios, and that's what this Table 4 shows. So in year three of 3 consecutive dry years, multiple dry years, in the original one I had brought to you, the Table 4, and back in March, I had 40 million gallons as the estimated available local supplies. But when I went back to my notes and looked at the actual estimates per supply source, it's actually should only be 35 million gallons. So that I wanted to make that correction in Table 4, since I'm bringing it back to the board. It's not a huge, 35, 40, but, I wanted to make that correction. So, so that's the only change since March that I brought back to the board in Table 4. Everything else is identical to the March version of the plan. So we have 3 resolutions for you to consider. So resolution 2016-12 is specifically for approving the water shortage contingency plan with the change to Table 4. When at the end of the public hearing, the board can consider that. So the next item that I wanted to talk about is the Water Conservation Act of 2009, which has our mandated urban water use targets. Just as a reminder, this was included in the 2010. It was brand new for the 2010 Urban Water Management Plan. And it required us to calculate a baseline gross gallons per capita per day for a 10-year period and a 5-year period, with restrictions on what years we could use to create that baseline, and divide it by the population that we had. At the time, we didn't have 2010 census data available to us, So we knew that we were in the next urban water management plan, we would have to revise those calculations for GPCD, the gross, the gallons per day per capita, to incorporate the new census data. So and that's what we've done for the 2015 plan. So our baselines have changed and our targets have changed. And in this, the methodology that we used to determine our population, so not only was it what data source we could use, but DWR, we had to get our methodology approved because we weren't going to use the Department of Finance data because it's a little difficult to use that data if you're a water district that covers more than one jurisdiction. If you're a city, it's easy to use the Department of Finance data, but if you're if your jurisdiction kind of is in incorporated areas and city areas, it's a little bit harder to determine your population that way. So we had to use different methodology, and we can talk about that. It's in the plan, and we can talk about the actual methodology.
Kathleen, can I just kind of ask a general question then about
sure.
this? So the concept of this plan is not that it's a living document that gets updated and changed every time there's a change in the data, but rather it's a snapshot in time. And I ask that because based on what you were saying about how the 2010 document was done prior to the census data, mm-hmm. the census data changed, and so we're updating it now for the 2015.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why, I mean, it was a snapshot in time at that point in 2010 before we had the census data.
Yeah, you basically just use the best available data at the time to complete it, knowing that it might require amendments at the next update.
Okay.
Which is every 5 years.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. So the next slide actually shows what the new targets are. To determine your urban water use targets, you also have to pick a target method, and you had four to choose from. So you're able to choose one of the four that gives you the best numbers to work with some limitations. The district chose in 2010 method three, which is 95% of the hydrologic region target. And that's what we chose again for this cycle. So that's our method for determining our targets. And then with the recalculation, with the change in population, so population, when we used the new methodology in the 2010 census, we found that our population declined over what we had previously.
I wondered why it went up. These targets went up.
Yes, because we're dividing by a small number.
I didn't think there was any more water.
Yeah, so it's because of the population changes. So.
Interesting.
So, but it actually has worked out to our benefit.
Yeah, I know.
Because with so our baseline 10-year average increased, so it kind of gave us more room to work with, and so basically. The new calculation for our 10-year baseline gross GPCD turned out to be 148 gallons per day per person. And then in the 2010 urban water management plan, it was 128. So our 5-year baseline gross gallons per capita per day went to 150, and it was 127 in 2010. So you can see it changed significantly.
Great.
Went up. So using method three, our 2015 interim target turned out to be 136 gallons per day per capita. And we met that by having a gallons per day per capita in 2015 of 109. So we really met it, but we were under, again, a stage two water source contingency plan with the ordinance in place restricting irrigation and outdoor water use. So, and plus we had a lot of voluntary indoor water use. So we all know we've seen a huge decrease in sales. So, but we did meet the target, so that's a good thing. And then our 2020 target will be 124 gallons per day per person. And this is gross. I just want to point out, it's not residential. It can get kind of fusing because we say gallons per day per person, so we tend to think residential. But we have to take our total water production and divide it by population. So it's commercial use and everything. So this is our gross gallons per day per person. It's not residential.
So the average residential person will have most likely used significantly less than that 109.
Yeah, we're in the 50s. It kind of fluctuates, but and it's a little different for Half Moon Bay than our El Granada folks, but it's around, 55 gallons per day per person right now, give or take, just depending on winter, summer. So
So we expect between 15 and 20, there'll be an increase in population or in use of water by other. It's going down, is all I'm saying. And that's due mainly to
people conserving water being.
I mean, the difference between the 2015 and 2020 target was from 136 to 124.
Oh, so the.
What's the major impact of making it go down again?
You mean why is it 124 and not 130? You take the mid. They had us take the midpoint between our baseline and the. And then our final target to come up with this interim. So they want us to be able to track it.
That's nice.
But. The interim is different. It wasn't really a compliance thing. It was more of a checking to see where you are in meeting the 2020 goal.
So the formula sort of dictates how you do.
So any questions about the targets and how they changed or what the final? Okay. So resolution 2016-13, we're asking the board in that resolution to approve these targets and the baseline, the newly calculated ones with the updated population figures. Okay, so now we get to the urban water management plan. So for those of you who weren't with us in the 2010 cycle of updating the urban water management plan, thought we'd give some background. The urban water management plan is a planning document. It's supposed to have the district or water agencies look long term, and it's supposed to be a tool that's available for planning authorities, cities and counties, in helping them to know if there's enough water for development in the area. So if they keep building houses or whatever, so it's supposed to be a tool for other agencies also that they can refer to and reference. And again, Dave mentioned this a little bit, but the district really started preparing for the urban water management plan in May of 2013 with BOSCA and with Madouse Water Management to start work on our projections. So Madouse Consulting came up with a model and a revised model. We used their model in 2010, but they had revised it since the 2010 model, and they had taken into a, they updated the model to be able to take into account climate of an area using, if an area had CIMIS data, they could use CIMIS data or spatial CIMIS data. And it updated the model with the current codes. If anyone's known about building lately and green codes and that, there's been a lot of changes to try to make building more efficient, water efficient and energy efficient. So it took into account those, that's kind of considered what we call passive saving, where there's some other regulatory trigger causing water conservation, whether the water district does anything or not about, their conservation program. So this model was updated with all that, and it's a lot of data entry, a lot of data being entered into it. So we started that in 2013, and then as we got closer to the actual urban water management plan process, we updated it as much as we could in 2015, and we ended up paying, I think, Madouse about $10,000 to do the update in 2015. Okay, so the requirement to do an urban water management plan, it again is the in the California Water Code, their Urban Water Management Planning Act, and it has a threshold for the water agencies that need to do one of these. Not every water agency needs to do an urban water management plan. You have to meet the threshold, so you have to have at least 3,000 customers or more than 3,000 acre feet per year of supply. So the district does meet the definition of the urban water supplier, so we do have to do these plans. Okay. So in 2015, because of the drought, and probably some other issues, but I think mainly the drought, there was a lot of legislation changing the code for urban water management plans. So there was a lot of new requirements. One was the specific methodologies for determining your population, which we talked about a little bit about that. The quantification reporting of your distribution system water loss using a specific methodology, which is why we hired Water Systems Optimization and worked with them for a year in 2014 to help prepare that. So that the work that Water Systems Optimization or WSO did is included in this urban water management plan. They added stuff about wastewater treatment and recycled water, and they changed how we report on our conservation programs, which are called demand management measures, and they incorporated a lot more standardized forms and tables, and changed the way we submit information to DWR on this plan through an electronic submittal portal. Okay. So the key components of the district's plan in Chapter 4 are where you can find the water demand projections, which we use the Madaus model for that. In Chapter 5 has the description of our Water Conservation Act of 2009 compliance with the urban water use targets and baselines. The water supply availability and reliabilities are in Chapter 6 and 7. The water shortage contingency plans in Chapter 8, and then our conservation programs where we quantify our savings from our different programs is in Chapter 9. So if you have any questions about that, we can move on. So this graph chart, actually, it shows the demand projections, the historical. So I must say that it was a huge challenge to do these projections, even with the model, because there was so much change. We had the economic downturn starting around 2009 or so, 2008. We had a drought between 2000 and 2009. Then we had this other drought starting around 2012 and 2013. So we really haven't had a normal year. I mean, 2013 kind of was considered normal, but and part of the process of developing projections is you look at your past usage. So it was really difficult to look at the recent past consumption to develop the projections for the future. So again, the demand modeling, we did take into account a lot of new methodologies and looking at climate, CIMIS data, the new population methodology, passive savings. They looked at our service area characterization. They look at, how many of our customers are residential, how many are commercial, what kind of commercial, and, to determine all the way down to the end uses of toilets and showers and things like that to make this model work and come up with good projections. So you'll see that the projections are pretty flat, and they're a lot lower than what we projected would be in the 2010 plan. So no projection is perfect. Having worked on these plans for quite a while, projections are tricky, and it's very rare for projections to turn out to be very accurate, but it is required. We have to do it as part of the plan, these projections. DWR has worked very closely with Madaus Water Management on their demand modeling, and they're very, and they have expressed their confidence in it, that it includes all the elements that the Department of Water Resources is comfortable with and should be in any kind of modeling of demand projection.
So what kind of commitment are we making by declaring whatever the numbers would end up being?
It's a good question.
How accountable will we be?
It's not, there's no commitment other than what we're telling, with especially with this graph, supply and demand projections, that we have enough supply to meet demand up to 2040, you know, as best as we can determine, you know, out to 2040, 2035. That's the major, I think, message or what we're trying to communicate with this.
But it is, as an example, wouldn't city planners look at this and determine whether there was room for development or not based on this data?
Yes, they would look at that. But of course, we here on the Coastside have unique coastal
commission.
In theory,
they would look at it in other cities.
In other cities, if they had connections to sell. But our situation here is so unique that they can't look at that and make a determination. There's other restrictions on growth here because of the Coastal Commission or on the coast. So they can't. So here, the county and the city of Half Moon Bay cannot just look at that. They have to actually look at their local coastal plan and other regulations. But in other areas of the state, this might be all they need to look at to make that determination. So everywhere, everywhere's, you know, unique. But it's a good rough check for us also to look at, you know, our supplies, I mean, and see if we need, you know, we want to try to maximize our local sources, you know, things like that. So it's a good check. Not saying that it's a perfect projection or model, but it's definitely a good check, and it's the best we can do with the data that we have and the information. So any other questions about this particular chart that the board wants to go over before we move on? Nope. Okay. I just saw some faces.
With respect to projections, I just comment that there are a lot of projections. We're always doing projections, so don't look for these projections to necessarily have any relationship to our budget projections. Those are done, we do those differently. So there's no, and we're constantly being asked to make projections, and we really, although we'd like to be, you know, in the ballpark, there's no real requirement or a lot of effort on our part put into trying to make all these projections match. The urban water management plan projections are done according to a particular model, which we may not necessarily use for any other purpose. So,
yeah.
Can you? The dotted blue line. It's not shown in the. I don't see it in the next particular. Just dotted the guy, the one coming off 738.
Yes.
Tell me about it.
That was what we projected.
2010 plan.
In the 2010 plan, yeah.
Okay, so that's what we predicted back then.
Yeah.
And we've changed that prediction significantly.
Significantly, right? Yes.
And does this also imply that the Tulisitos and Denniston supplies will be constant or appear to be there during that entire period? Is that what, that's what that infers? I'm just trying to.
Yeah, I didn't. I didn't really include San Vicente. I did include, since we've done the improvements to Denniston Treatment Plant, those improvements. And I didn't make a lot of projections about improvements from our Pilocitos infiltration wells.
Right.
You know.
You went with what you know as far as.
Yeah, it's a very conservative.
No, it's fine. And it appears, I mean, on the face of it, that we have significant supply to.
In a normal year, yes.
To meet the demands, which are much lower than previously projected.
Yes.
But not a lot higher than what we're seeing right now.
Right.
Okay.
So it's kind of,
I understand.
We kind of protecting a flatter demand. Yes.
I can't really read the numbers, but it looks like it goes 876, 738, 666. But then it looks to me like it goes 671, and then does it go
down
661, and then 648, and then
so some of that has to do with
669 and 692. Is that basically where it goes?
Yeah. So some of that is due to code changes, a building code of what's projected in the future now, you know, and then population as population increases and decreases.
Well, I guess what confused me is that 738 looks to be lower than those other numbers, but I guess it's just the color is buffaloing my
this
brain.
This is SF, the blue is SF, the supply from SFPC.
No, he means the top of the 738 is lower
than 692.
Is higher.
Yeah.
Lower than
692.
They don't look like they relate to one another. I guess.
The scale.
Oh,
the scale looks.
The scale.
It looks a little funny.
So I don't really love that.
Okay.
I encourage that those scales relate to one another.
It's where the triangle.
Seven. I'm not.
The last.
Six.
The last bar.
Right here, where the black line is 692.
Yeah, it's 692 is Ken's point, and that's.
It looks higher than 738.
Not maybe quite, actually.
Maybe I can't see that.
The top of the column looks higher.
Yeah.
Maybe.
But that's not the
672. I guess it's because the blue.
Low.
I guess it's because the blue goes all the way up.
Right.
To that line.
So they had to make the, the projection.
So those are on the left side are the actual supply component contributions for those years.
Right.
On the right side are the, you know, our estimated normal year yields.
Yeah, it just looks like the blue
maximum.
Looks like the blue ought to be in a different location on one of those bars.
The blue is just your PUC supply. The 692 is the actual black line.
The triangle
black line
is
that's maybe
right.
That's what
the triangle is the 692.
I see. So graphically, it just looks confusing to me.
Well, they had to make it taller on the projected side in order to account for the 2010 projections.
Mm-hmm. I understand now, but it's
awkward.
It's a lot on one graph, on one chart.
Well, they just don't look like they relate. The colors don't look, I don't know.
Yeah, sometimes stat, we're so into it, we understand it's hard. So it's good to get feedback on how others perceive the chart.
Yeah, well, I don't read that well anyway, so.
Okay. So the demand management measures, they include our water waste prevention ordinances, the requirement that we meter all of our customers, our conservation pricing, that's the tiered rates that we have, public education and outreach, and the distribution system real losses, which is our water audit, which we use WSO on, the staffing for our water conservation program, which is me, and any other conservation programs like rebates and incentives and things like that. So the distribution system real loss work that we did with WSO is continuing. We're involved with AWWA and DWRs. They're calling it a TAP program so that we can comply with Senate Bill 555. Which requires us now to submit these audits to the state annually. The first one's due in 2017. So the work continues. So what the actions that we've completed to date is providing the 60-day notice to San Mateo County and other interested parties that might be interested in our urban water management plan. We've provided draft copies. We've put it on our website, and we've kept a copy here in our office for anyone who wanted to see it and didn't have access to the internet. We usually give a copy to the library, but but that would be a little difficult this year considering they've bulldozed it and they're under construction. And then we
put it in a time capsule.
We could have put in a time capsule.
Buried under the foundation of the new library.
It's a good idea. And we've done the noticing and the Half Moon Bay review for the public hearing.
With the right date.
With the right date, thank you. I've been paranoid about that. I don't know how many times I checked that. So we also did an electronic newsletter notifying this hearing. So anyone who signed up for our newsletter got that. And then in February, I put an ad in the paper for the general public, just in case they don't look at legal notices, that, you know, they could see that in an actual ad in the Half Moon Bay review. Okay, so upon adoption of the urban water management plan, that's when we'll need to submit that to electronically to the Department of Water Resources using the new online tool they have, portal. We'll have to send a copy to the California State Library. We will send copies to, or at least a link to let the county and the city know where the document lives, because we'll put it on our website so people can reference it. And usually SFPUC will notify them and BOSCA agencies that it's on our website. We'll always keep a hard copy here at the district for anybody who wants to look at it. And again, like I said, it'll be posted on our website also. So resolution 2016-14 is to adopt the 2015 Urban Water Management Plan update. So if we have any comments from the public on my presentation, now's the time for that.
So having heard the staff report on the Urban Water Management Plan, then the public hearing is open for any members of the public who would like to address the board regarding this plan or any questions you may have about the resolutions that we will be considering this evening. Okay, hearing none. Then I'll close the public hearing and open discussion from the board. And I think the way to approach this would be to have a motion and a second on the table, and then we know what we're discussing. Is there a motion?
I'd like to move we adopt 12, 13, and 14.
Okay, we have a motion to adopt the three resolutions. Is there a second?
A second.
And we have a second. Okay, let's throw it open to board discussion then. Any comments from the board? Any questions? Any issues?
I read it. And I'm referring to number three, the Urban Water Management Plan. And my, I'd like time to go over so I either understand it or clarify the questions or issues I have. And so my thought was to not do that, taking up, you know, the five of us, for a 2-hour talk session, do it at a committee meeting. It delays our submittal of this, but quite frankly, the date only covers 2015, so it doesn't bother me at all to delay it a month. But as it stands, because I have so many questions and sort of comments on it, I'm not able to endorse this at this time.
Is there any legal implication to having noticed it tonight and at a public meeting but then delay it? Do we have to do it again?
We have to do everything again.
We have to do this all over.
Right.
What?
Well, it depends.
If you don't change the plan.
If you change anything.
Yeah. You've noticed it. You've had a public hearing on the plan as it stands. And so if the plan didn't change and you wanted to bring it back at the next meeting and say, we will adopt it or we'll make some minor edits that don't substantially change the plan, I don't believe you'd have to reopen the public hearing.
And if you also made some minor ministerial changes, I don't think you would need to go through the whole process again. But if you're making some substantive changes, you had a public hearing on something that's different than what is in your plan. So it really depends on what happens.
I for one am uncomfortable about tabling. I'm ready to proceed.
I mean, I had it a month ago. Let me just put it a different way. I went through it numerous times. And I understand, you know, the technical things, I'm not as a student. However, to me, this is no mean piece, I mean, this is no walk in the park, this plan. And the effort and attention by Kathleen and Elizabeth and the folks who worked on this make me feel comfortable to the nth degree in terms of what has been delivered. I think it's a fine plan. I think it covers the territory. I thought of it as a way to tell the public, personally, what we're about and what we hope to be. That's what this is. It's sort of our mantra of who we are as a water district. And I didn't find anything there that was missing, in my view. And if you followed all the rules and you did everything procedurally that's appropriate and you followed the instructions and mapped in all the things that need to be there, I'm not sure what else I could ask you to do at this point. I mean, my opinion, let me put it that way. So I'm fine with it. I would prefer not to see it delayed, but that's my if it is, it will be. But I think it's time to get on with other business. You've done this for a long time, and it's, you know, you've had enough of it.
So I'm inclined also not to table it, but I do have a question.
Sure.
The board's responsibility is to deal with things at the policy level. We have one director who has a significant number of issues that may or may mm-hmm. not be issues, questions.
Right.
May or may not turn out to be issues. So in the event that Glenn has an opportunity to sit down with Kathleen or whoever he needs to sit down with, go through all of his questions, and it turns out that there are some policy issues that need to be addressed, can those policy issues be worked through, recognizing that we have a process for establishing policies in the district, and that's going to take some time? And once that would happen, would it be possible to amend, or do we have to wait until 2020?
No, you can amend the plan. It requires another public hearing, but you can amend the plan at any time.
Okay, so there's a vehicle, should the need arise, mm-hmm. based on some of the concerns that Glenn may have, there is a vehicle for working that through.
I'd also like to point out that this is not a policy-making
right.
document. There is nothing, I call it a snapshot, and I think that's right. kind of accurate. There are water supply policies, recycled water policies, mm-hmm. as an example, that the board really hasn't worked on, that if we had them would be incorporated in the urban water management mm-hmm. plan. But it's not, you know, it's not the purpose of the urban water management plan to try to make policy. It just says, well, here's the picture. I think some of the questions we've got, Director Coverdell had a question about the discussion of recycled water. Well, there's lots of enthusiasm for recycled water, but this board has never made any policy about recycled water. I think that's going to be a one of the key topics for the strategic planning session we mm-hmm. have coming up. When we've officially said it's our goal to have X amount of recycled water, then that would go in the urban water management plan. You know, right now we can't really, you know, if we're dissatisfied about that discussion, we need to bring it back to the board and say, well, let's make some policy. But we haven't, I think consideration of the kinds of questions that could be raised will guide us in the kinds of policy discussions we may want to have. But we haven't typically regarded the urban water management plan as a vehicle for making policy. And it certainly, you would find no surprises in terms of, you know, it doesn't say anything that isn't district, you know, that isn't district policy already. So there isn't anything in here that would make district policy. It just, you know, since you mentioned policy,
right.
I want to just point that out.
Okay, that's important to know. While we're thinking about that, I'd like to just ask a couple of questions that mm-hmm. came up while I was reading it that are not substantive, but just occurred to me as I was reading it. One was on chapter 3, page 3, where we're talking about growth and development of the district, and it's subject to city and county growth management policies. One of the questions I had was, what role does the Coastal Commission play? Because they seem to have the authority to limit water connections and through their policies. And should the Coastal Commission have been indicated as one of the agencies that does have influence over growth and development in our service area? What was this one? Oh, again, none of these are, have to happen. They were just thoughts. On, in chapter 7-3, I was wondering if the issues around or the impact of the mountain tunnel on water supply from SFPUC is something that should be mentioned as something that's out there as a looming potential issue for us. I have no idea what that note said or why I said it. Well, we'll just move on. Oh, on chapter 8-9, we talk about emergency water supply agreement, and I just had a question about whether we should have emergency electrical supply available to pump water over the hill to Nunez plant. Do we have that?
No.
Because we talked about Crystal Springs and getting water over so in an emergency.
That's one of the things that really bugs me about this, is we say we get all our water from Crystal Springs, but if the power goes out, we can't get that water.
Right.
So that's why I can't endorse this. Right. I'm really, you know, stuff like that. I feel that if we're saying we get 80% of our water from San Francisco, but oh, by the way, if the power goes out, we can't get it. I don't feel that I can face the public and say we never imagined we'd lose electricity and not be able to pump water. We're sorry you don't have any water.
Right. So I don't feel strongly that it has to be here in this plan, but it did raise the question in my mind, and perhaps that's something we need to address separately from the urban water management.
And I'm happy to address those things separately. What really bugs me is that if we're going to put this statement out and say this is our roadmap for the next 5 years, and we throw these zingers out there and just leave them, like, well, did you read your own document? You know, we have no, it's... And so I'll give you another one that's exactly parallel to that I'm really uncomfortable about our saying on public record that this is how we're planning for the public. Section 9, which is demand management, we've got a section on our commercial industrial conservation program, and I'm reading it. There is no estimated savings from the customer conservation program for our C2 customers. And then the next sentence says, implementation of this is expected to help the district achieve its water use targets by reducing the amount of water consumed by its customers. So we're saying we don't conserve any water, the program isn't doing any good, but that's going to help us meet our targets?
I'm not saying there's not savings, we just haven't quantified them. It's a little...
I'm just reading it, and I had a pretty good suspicion that what you meant was you didn't include the estimated savings, mm-hmm. But when I read it, it says there are no estimated savings from this sector. So well, upon the public...
But which that means there that? Currently aren't any.
So then why are we running the program?
Well, because we may anticipate that's going to be useful
that's
in the future.
Comment.
I mean, that's what the language says. If you read it carefully, it says...
I read it really carefully. It says we have no savings from this sector.
Well, we don't currently have it.
We do. It's part of our plan. It's part of the projections that go in to make these numbers.
Did you estimate savings?
They're passive savings, not, at this point, active savings. They're the code changes and things like that. Yeah. And it's also, with commercial, it's mostly the conservation price and the price for far water drives a lot of the commercial conservation.
Should we, you've asked three questions. Do you want us to address those?
Yeah, or
okay.
That'd be fine.
I'll handle the Coastal Commission one.
Yes, okay.
Coastal Commission's planning authority is indirect. It's the city of Half Moon Bay and the county of San Mateo who are the planning agencies, and they express their plans in local coastal programs that are certified by the Coastal Commission. So it's only on appeal that the Coastal Commission has direct planning authority. So they do have an influence. I mean, they are involved, but...
But they're not really the actual planning agencies.
Yeah, they're not. We don't have to go to the Coastal Commission to do anything.
Ah, okay.
So the second, Chapter 7, Mount Tunnel, the wording regarding San Francisco came from San Francisco SFPUC. They, as our wholesaler, provide us with this wording. So this isn't something we wrote. It's something we incorporated from San Francisco standard wording. But, I mean, I do agree with, so why they didn't include Mount, I think it's because it's been a recent development, and when they were developing the standard wording, because again, remember, we kind of started this early in order to meet requirements, so I think when they were developing the standard wording, it wasn't quite such a priority. But if they were to write it today, I'm sure they would have included it.
It's hit the newspaper now, so now, yeah, it's current.
Yeah. So there's a little bit of, you know, that delay. I think if they had written it today, it would include it.
And perhaps it's better to wait until there's some resolution on what they're going to do anyway and include it in the next plan. Mm-hmm. But
yeah.
And they provide what they call it standard language that they provide to all the Bosca customers, mm-hmm. so that you don't have mm-hmm. 30 different customers saying something different about the SFPUC.
Got it.
So you, in essence, have put into this plan everything that was in place at this snapshot in time.
Yes.
But that could change going forward. Mm-hmm. But we don't necessarily know what the change will be. Mm-hmm. And so it's hard to...
Yeah, what do you put in?
What do you put in? And when we know what to put in, then we'll either see if it means that we have to do something else to amend this or wait to refresh this plan in 2020. Mm-hmm. We did the first one in 10, right? Was our first urban renewal?
Well, there was one in 2005.
How was it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, actually, that. Oh, yeah, I don't remember. Yeah, actually, it's been around for quite, when was the first one?
83.
83, yeah.
Oh, okay, no, but so, the one I was first was
yeah,
in 10, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm sorry. How much of what went on in 10 to 15 was by omission a big problem for us? Was there any real
population?
Okay.
Was, I would say, the biggest.
Okay.
Issue that changed numbers for our...
This one.
Yeah.
And so
that's the biggest change of population.
We may have other things that come down the road that will change things in this plan that we don't know yet, but we can adapt at the next go-around or do whatever we have to fix. In terms of the emergency stuff,
yeah, let me ask.
That's a strategic disaster recovery kind of discussion, which is not, in my view, part of what this is about. If we have disasters, we have to ways to get out of them. But I don't think we'll have enough information or process in place to necessarily make any statement here that is accurate.
I don't think and I think that's a good comment. I mean, I think the emergency.
I mean, that's my.
The emergency power at Crystal Springs is a good example of the kind of thing that this is not intended to cover. This is not intended to be like a vulnerability assessment.
Right.
It states the fact of the matter, which is we do not have emergency power at Crystal Springs. That isn't something we haven't thought about. We have spent a lot of effort looking at emergency power at Crystal Springs and thinking about how we would do that and what our vulnerability to loss of power at Crystal Springs may be. That isn't within the scope of this. I can tell you that we can get a lot of the year we can meet the district's need with gravity flow from Pilarcitos Lake. So, and we have Denniston as well. We have emergency power at Nunes. We have 8 or 10 million gallons in storage. So, it isn't like if Crystal Springs goes down, which we think is a pretty unlikely event, that we won't have any water. So, but again, you know, that isn't. Talking about that, those kinds of vulnerabilities is kind of beyond the scope of this. I think it's beyond the scope of this document. I mean, they're really legitimate questions, important questions, but that isn't what the urban water management plan isn't, doesn't really focus on reliability. Is that fair to say? On vulnerability to disasters, I mean, other than kind of a generic.
Its purpose is quite blatant, to show that, that we have thought how we can have a reliable water supply. And one of those issues is a water shortage from drought, which this focuses on very well, in my opinion. But to sit here and say, oh, well, the electricity went out, and so you can't have water because we didn't think that was part of the, I mean, that's the whole point of the urban water management plan, is to say it's a roadmap that you've thought through how you're going to provide water and how many houses it can support and how, what size population. And I agree with you completely that you wouldn't address the solution here. Totally agree with that. But as I read through it, we do throw some stuff. Another one that I'm pretty upset about is we show a significant reduction in demand due to plumbing code changes. And I frankly don't believe it. I'd really like to see the data. And I get it that we took it from a table that's been given to us, but I...
No, it's in the model, and it's, you know, it's in code, and it's been approved. DWR has seen that, and they agree with how the model handles.
I think this is a case where I question it. I don't think we're going to see the kind of reduction in conservation that this report puts forward. We've not been able historically, when we have water conservation, our residents make reductions and restrictions, but it's a diminishing returns. And every time we put out that request for conservation, people can't keep conserving. There's only so low we can get. And so I frankly can't support that idea that we're going to significantly reduce our demand through plumbing changes. I don't see it.
Well, we have seen it, especially with the code changes in California in 92 and 94.
They were huge.
We have seen.
Yeah, no, it was fantastic, but that was the low-hanging fruit. And when you read Vickers' books on her new book on water conservation and residential use, she is pretty blunt that the low-hanging fruit's been harvested. It's going to be a lot harder, and yet we've got some pretty ambitious data in here on how much water we're going to save through conservation, through plumbing changes.
And there's landscape. There's been a lot of changes.
It's split out in here just as residential plumbing changes.
Yeah,
but that's why I asked the question that I did about what commitments are we making to those numbers. And it sounds like...
No, you're just making your best guess.
Yeah, I mean, you're just projecting.
That's what this is. It's a view of going forward. I'm having difficulty using this as another kind of document, which is a strategic planning document, which talks to some of these issues that he's bringing up, which are very good issues to discuss in that forum, which we're going to have, hopefully, in November sometime, about things we haven't talked to for many years. I think that's where to discuss that. I think perhaps the issues you have that you don't see things that you want is those should be swept from here and put into the list of things we need to discuss in that strategic planning session. I think this stands on its own as what has been requested with the data that's been available and with the instructions we've been giving from the state and the other people who are involved in this to put out. And we're, July, right? So we're already a couple of months late. But I would not like to see this go for another month. I would like to be in the front of giving our data back to the state and saying, we've done it. We spent a good deal of money. We've put a lot of energy and commitment into it, and you have it. And we want to know if you have any problems with it. In the meantime, we need to get on with some of the issues we have with things that maybe aren't as well thought out or seen in the future of our organization in our strategic planning session. So I have no problem with what you're saying. I'm saying I don't think this is the place for it in this book. And I don't think by discussing it for another month will necessarily change anything that I think isn't here already or make it a different document. I just as soon get on with it and start working on strategic planning or the important issues that Glenn brings up about how do we protect ourselves if the dam Crystal Springs plant goes away.
May I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
One of the things that I think can happen here, which I would urge to occur, is I think we should adopt this plan. I think we should set up a subcommittee, and I think Glenn, obviously, is a person that's very interested in getting some of these things aired out. I think that's an appropriate meeting to have with Kathleen or and somebody else who might be interested, or just Glenn. I think these things can be aired out.
Mm-hmm.
I think we can easily make a list, and I think that list can come back to the board, you know, as a policy list.
Mm-hmm.
And if we decide that we need to modify this, then we'll modify.
All right.
And if not, in 5 years, we can make sure that we address those issues and do a better job of it. And I think that by doing it that way, we come close to meeting the deadlines. I think that's important. I think you've done a great job. I don't disagree with anything you bring up. Mm-hmm. There's nothing that I would, say, gee, Glenn, I think that's just being nitpicky or crazy. I value your opinion, and I know you've read it carefully. So I don't want to, have that occur and have you feel like we've ignored or we haven't, paid attention to what you think, because I value your opinion highly. And I just think the venue can be constructed. And if things come back out of that meeting in your report, and there's three items that are driving us crazy, I think we can easily adjust the report and have another public hearing and reissue the thing, right?
Okay.
If that's that may not be the first choice, but that's what I would like to see occur.
Can we fix the low-hanging fruit on this?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Chapter 6-15, halfway down. The use of recycled water at the cemetery would eliminate high-quality potable water that's currently provided by the district and used solely for irrigation. I was to understand that we sold raw water to Skylon, so I don't understand that statement.
Well, it's raw, but it's potable, isn't it?
No, it's raw water. We have to run it through Nooney's treatment plant before we can give it to the public. And we say that before that in this document. We explain that the raw water comes from Crystal Springs, goes to Nooney's, gets treated and is made potable water, and that the cemetery buys an interruptible supply of raw, non-potable water. We say that earlier in the document, and then we say, boy, if we have recycled water, that'll save all that great potable water we're putting on the cemetery. So it's a conflict within the document.
It shouldn't say potable water.
Correct.
But, okay. It is still high quality. Mm-hmm. We can make that correction.
Yeah, it's just simple.
So do you want just the word potable or high quality?
Frankly, potable is what's really, okay. I feel. High quality is here nor there, but it's potable.
Well, one could take that to, if you provide them with recycled water, they use less raw water, which then becomes water for us to make potable for people here in the
community.
I mean,
and that's
the same point.
But that's what it's got to say.
Should we add the fact that we'll never be able to afford to put a pipe from the recycled water?
So I agree with your statement, but I wasn't going to go there. I wasn't going to go there.
I don't know. He'll pay for that one.
If we're doing other low-hanging fruit, we need to take the word bumble and change it, because we're bumbling.
Where's that?
It'll take me a minute. Give me a sec. I'm going
to get
marked in here.
I think you can just make a list of these approved accepted activities. Minor edits.
Right in the middle of the page, so I know I'll see it when I get there. There it is. 6-12, we have small bumbles. And I'm just thinking we should get rid of the bumbles.
What is a bumble?
It meant to be bubbles, but the
bumbles?
Word was a typo.
So that's a typo, huh?
Changed it to bumbles.
Then, I wonder where all those bees were.
Is that
going?
A typo?
It's a typo, or it's a word autocorrect.
That doesn't have to go on the strategic planning.
Autocorrect is struck.
I think we better solve for a month.
What?
we'll make that correction.
Yep. Yeah, I just thought before, those are the low-hanging.
Absolutely.
And can these be corrected offline typos?
Yes.
We approve this thing anyway.
Offline, but the things like the first one, you should be doing now so you can direct staff to
you can approve it as it will be amended and direct staff to amend the changes, including all typos.
Okay, nicely done, very good.
So if the fish in Crystal Springs like the water, it's still not potable, is that what I'm to assume?
Did you have any others, Glenn?
So what I wanted, I'm sorting out the non-substantive typo ones mm-hmm. from the strategic sort of planning ones.
I think the blue ones differ from the yellow ones.
Because I ran out of yellow.
Good reason. I just didn't know
ran out of blue.
Like a severity or more than one error.
I am not case. That organized.
In the interest of time, can we just stipulate in the motion, Ken, I think it was your motion, that the typos will be identified and changed and that's within... Do we need it even to say that?
I think actually I'm done with my typo.
I like that.
Okay.
I like small
bumps. Then I take that back.
Yeah.
I'm concerned about the ones where you have equations written.
I don't think we get much public comment on small bumbles, actually.
Spell check. It likes bumbles.
Well, I don't know. When I turn on the faucet, I don't want a bunch of bubbles.
Bumbles.
Honey, bubbles.
Okay.
Okay, so we have a motion.
The book is closed. We have a motion. We have a second. So ready for a vote.
Hold on, just to clarify, The motion is to make the changes to raw potable water versus raw water. There was one change that was going to be made, and the staff will make all correction of typos.
Yeah.
So that's their directed to do, and you're approving it.
Right, and for clarification purposes, we are taking action on the approval of 12, which is adopting an updated water shortage contingency plan, 13, approving an updated baseline daily per capita use, an updated urban water use target, and an updated interim water use target, and 14 is the adoption of the 2015 urban water management plan.
You want them separately?
Are they separate or
no, the recommendation was to do it together.
To
so,
yeah, cool.
Joanne.
Yes. Dr. Coverdell.
Hi.
Vice President Reynolds.
No.
Dr. Feldman.
Yes.
President Glassberg.
Yes.
President Glassberg. And so if it still seems reasonable, I really would encourage the consideration of appointing a special subcommittee to review the urban water management plan with Kathleen.
How would you feel if Glenn met and got all of his questions and addressed and answered, and then we make the determination if we need a separate committee for it?
I think that's why you're president, and I'm just sitting over here under him as an executor.
I take that as a yes. Okay. So staff will make arrangements with Director Reynolds to get together. Okay. Super.
Thank you.
Thank you, and thank you to the vast public who came and gave us feedback on our urban water management plan.
I feel really bad about it. If these gentlemen are here for an item, can we move that to the next item?
We only have a couple of items.
To help them, they may not be here for them.
It's for consent.
Here for the consent items, just in case there are any questions.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay. We're doing
all right,
it now.
Then we're there. Okay, very good. And Glenn, thank you for raising your issues and bringing to light things that we wouldn't necessarily have seen, and it helps clarify it for all of us. So good. Democracy works, at least at Coastside County Water. Okay, consent calendar. Are there any items that any directors would like to have pulled?
I would actually like to discuss B, and I would like to discuss the... I'm not sure where I found this one, the Calcom T&M project.
That's funny. That sounds familiar.
Where is it?
Calcom, yeah, the contract list.
I'm not sure which one.
Which item is that, though?
And are you guys from Calcom?
No.
Is that item, that's in B, right?
It's
last
B.
One,
it's
last item.
I think Calcom's in B.
T&M
okay.
Projects.
All right, then.
Tracking.
Okay. So is there a motion to approve the consent calendar excluding item B?
Do we have to exclude it or do you have a question?
Well, we're supposed to vote on all of them or exclude an item.
Oh, we can't discuss
it. Take separate action on, then we can discuss it.
Okay. No, it's fine.
I move we approve all except item B under the consent calendar.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Motion and a second. This is consent. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Aye. Okay, hearing none, the motion passes. Director Coverdell, item B.
Okay.
What? Item B is acceptance of financial reports.
You were item J, so you're good.
I'm sorry you had to wait. I really apologize to you.
Fascinating, wasn't it? Yeah.
I apologize to you for that. But thanks for coming. You want to talk about the urban water? Have you found anything in the... I'm sorry, I don't mean to take levity. So I had a question. On the monthly budget report in August, we're looking at water revenue. So my question is, does this report have our rate increases occurred as of this report?
Yes.
Don't look at me.
He was in Moscow.
You're in charge.
Any money questions that direct?
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Miss Moneypenny. I'm sorry, I didn't say that to be rude. I apologize to you, but...
Yeah, yeah.
But they have...
Yes.
Been incorporated.
Right.
So I just wanted to point out the fact that our August activity exceeds our August budget, including the increase in price.
Yes.
Of our rates.
Our July revenue was higher than what we projected, and our August revenue was pretty much right on to what we projected.
But still higher.
But still higher, so in total, for the 2 months.
Yeah.
And I will also note on this is that our water purchased is, we have a savings because we've been operating Denniston.
Yes.
And so between water and electricity, we have substantial savings for the first 2 months.
And I appreciate the savings, but we have a big bill to pay off.
Right.
From that particular project, so I see it as a contribution to an expense as opposed to a big savings.
Our budget assumed that we wouldn't get any production out of
Denniston yeah.
from July through, what, yeah. November, something
right,
like
yeah.
that.
Right, yeah. And so we
spectacular that, yeah. that we've got.
It was I think it was a much better water year than we kind of anticipated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that the coastal streams have been active. Yeah. You know, mm-hmm. the stream where I live has run up until about 2 weeks ago.
Shows how quickly the streams recover, Denniston yeah. in particular. Yeah. But the cool weather has also lowered the ag demand,
yes.
which is a big factor.
Because that's a big factor, oh, yeah. isn't it? When yeah. he needs the water,
yeah, really
he asks
big.
Us to stop.
Last summer was very different.
Yeah. Oh, that was crazy. Last
so our revenue went up and our expenses, August expenses compared to budget went down. And mm-hmm. I know that that's just a slice yeah. in time, but yeah. at least it's in the right direction for the mm-hmm. slice in time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think it's a great slice.
Yeah.
We haven't seen that for a long time.
Yeah. But obviously we're early in the year too in terms of our expenses, so there's...
Yeah.
But I really appreciate it.
Things don't always come through in the month you think they're going to come through. Okay. Any other questions about
yeah,
that?
Yeah, so I have one other, if I may. I'm sort of disturbed by the Calcon T&M project situation.
We need to revise the schedule. The schedule, what actually we had on, we need to put in, we have, you, in our CIP for last year, we had 200,000 in SCADA, which is really, should be this number that should be the budget on the schedule for
thank you very much.
Great minds think alike.
Yeah.
I had sent her a message
yeah.
about that very same line item. That's why I laughed when you said that. And she promised, made a commitment to redo this yeah. by the October meeting to show the truth as it is. And it makes the that big net thing go away.
Yeah.
Negative thing, I'm sorry. Because it was done last March, a long time ago, and I wasn't even here
August,
when they did it.
Yeah.
So.
You do realize that we agree on all these
yeah,
things.
No, that's cool, man. That's same, I loved it. I didn't pull it because she'd already answered the question.
So well, I was just passing out because we had a discussion yeah. about it. You know, when this was approved as TM, there was a huge discussion about
right.
where is this going to go and what's up. And so I just wanted to be sure that if it wasn't as it is. So enough said, it is something different, and thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think they're doing a great job. It doesn't have anything to do with the work.
I love you.
It's just when the numbers start looking like that in my life, I start shaking.
Yeah, the big numbers. So in the interest of continuing to nitpick on spelling, which I wouldn't have seen if Director Coverdale hadn't brought it up, but the bottom of that exhibit, the count.
Yes, yes.
Permanganangangangangangate.
Should be
bumble.
It should be
bumble.
Should be bumble.
That's a bumble. Yeah, should be a bubble.
Should be bumbles.
So I move we approve B.
with that.
Oh, I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes. Okay. Meetings attended, director's comments. Anybody have something to contribute?
We do, we have a huge contribution.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Just don't count this against my time record, that's all.
I have no comment.
Fair enough.
Well, you already set a record, so we don't have to worry.
Oh, I feel okay then.
So my illustrious compatriot on my left and I attended a recycle water committee meeting.
Oh, I'd love it.
And it was held here, and it was extremely well attended. I mean, everybody was here, all the representatives from all the parties. And it was an extremely frustrating meeting because it was basically an attempt on the city's part to elaborate why they wouldn't approve the 25% design on the recycled water treatment facility. And it got pretty heated. It got personal. I thought Glenn did a marvelous job. Really, I thought he was lucid. I thought he, you know, kept things in check that could have gone a little bit crazy.
He's just saying that so I'll stay doing the president thing.
It did get a little out there, which is really sad. But the truth of the matter is, if we didn't agree to go back and get SRT to come back with a new proposal to reevaluate the project and answer a bunch of questions for the city was out. And so I think we would have been in kind of a funny position. Since then, SRT has come back and the numbers are radically higher and different. The customer that we have was willing to cough up some money to help this thing go forward, and I thought that was really generous. It, of course, was nowhere near, you know, what would be needed.
Right.
But it, I want to tell you that there was a high level of frustration in that meeting, and it's just disappointing because there are so many people that really want to try to figure out how to make this thing move forward, and it just seems like every time we start to make a progress, somebody sticks the oar in the water, and we start to spin, and it's kind of disappointing, to be really honest with you, because, you know, we were supposed to be pumping the water last March, and I think we'll be darn lucky if there's even an approval of a 25% design by this March. And so it's just, you know, it's one of those things where sometimes when you pull a heavy load and the load moves, then you don't mind the work. But when you pull a heavy load and you turn into Sisyphus and you start to push it and you up the hill and it rolls back over you, there's just something that feels sort of, you know, like, gosh, couldn't I, you know, sober up or wake up or realize that this is just, you know, never going to be able to come together. And it's disappointing because everyone's trying. And it's there are a lot of players in it that are trying so hard.
What was the city's objection?
When you say the, I'm sorry.
The cost. The money.
Oh.
They didn't, what they really object to, the number one thing is that reverse osmosis is imperative, as near as I can figure, in the near future. There may be some miracle. I'm sure the scientists are going to invent something that makes RO seem ridiculous. But right now, it's the only way to bring the water to a high enough quality standard to be reliable. Well, there are all these discussions about designing this plant without RO.
Oh.
And the city is feeling like, you know, this is ridiculous. And they brought their engineer, the city's new engineer, consulting or on staff?
Consultant.
And, you know, the person kind of got some resistance, but all the questions that that person asked were viable. Do you have enough space? Can you really fit all these parts in? You know, will these numbers really work? Why don't you have RO included in the beginning?
The part that I think that Ken really hits on is that we had run into this log jam 3, 4 months, 5 months before, and the way we chose to resolve it was to have, rather than a concept, which everybody agreed was a very nebulous, well, it's a concept, and we couldn't put a number, good or bad, on it. And frankly, I would have been really uncomfortable racing ahead on a really low concept number, just as I would be very, nobody wanted to race ahead with a high concept number. So the idea was to have a 25% design so that we weren't talking, we were talking apples to apples. And we could say, this is what it will cost, and this is what it'll take to build. And the city of Half Moon Bay does not like that approach. They want to pay for a concept to go back to the beginning and look at a concept and then say if they like that to move forward from that. And the part that's so frustrating is that everybody agrees that a concept won't have enough solidity for us to really gain anything. But we spend a lot more money and we waste a lot of time. And so I think that's why your analogy to feeling like we got rolled over.
No, it sounds like it.
So did you have a question before I jumped in?
So the Recycled Water Committee, was this Recycled Water Committee meeting?
Yeah.
Okay, and that was you folks for representing us.
Yeah.
And people representing the city, like Kowalczyk and others.
Granada. And Sam.
And then Sam is the general manager,
right.
Sam plus
Granada,
and then Granada and Montero.
Right.
Two yeah. each or one each?
It's two each.
Yeah. And so you got together to try and hammer out. Now, the 25% original design concept cost the city, what, $65,000 or something was what their share was? I don't remember. There was some number.
It changed because the original thing was less.
Yeah.
But the new numbers that have come back from SRT are much higher.
Way higher. The new ones. So they're 25, but their share would be higher between Sam.
Well, their share of just the concept. And that's sure. the difficulty is that we still need the 25%.
Okay. So it seems like you've made progress. I mean, as I looked at the progress reading the it actually, you seem to be moving right along there. You got to the point where at least you were talking a number where they could start doing something, and it's sort of
going backwards.
Gone backwards. Well, and for you see, you guys get, shall I say, disheartened with your optimistic view of partnerships. No, I'm just, that's what's making me nervous.
Yeah.
Is if you get disappointed, you get disheartened, then it can't be good, because you are the biggest optimist about working together with people and making partnering and all that stuff. So I'm really disappointed now. I'm starting to get disheartened.
Well, what happened?
I just wanted you to know that. I mean, you guys are really trying to work.
Well, what happened before that made us all mad, Bob,
yeah.
that really got us upset was everyone in the committee agreed
yeah.
to the 25%.
Right. Everyone.
So what happened was Sam went and got an approval.
Right, no, I saw right? I knew that.
You know, Montero got an approval.
I knew that, yeah.
Granada got an approval. So here we are, we're all, you know, everyone's kind of, yeah. And then, you know, then it hits the... Hits
yeah, but at the end of the day, I guess my bottom line is I'm not surprised.
I know.
I'm sorry.
So what was,
I'm not surprised.
What was the final resolution at that meeting?
Nothing. No, we
Nothing,
had to go
so
back.
Still and, an open issue.
Well, now we have the SRT proposals. The
resolution at the committee meeting was to ask SRT to redo
right.
its 25% design proposal to include...
Right.
reverse osmosis.
Right.
Why that was such an obstacle, I don't know, but this board
I'm glad you
clarified
good.
The district's position. CCWD is the one and the only customer right. for recycled water.
Right.
The principles of agreement said that
right.
CCWD would specify the quality right. and the quantity.
Right.
This board adopted
right.
Technical Memo 1
right.
As the quality specification. That really more or less ended the argument about whether this facility could be built without RO. But yeah. it took that, I think. And finally, this was the recognition that
mm-hmm.
Among everybody that RO had to be part of the project.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so the conclusion of the committee was that SRT should be requested to
mm-hmm.
update its proposal.
I'm glad you
which
came up
done.
With at least
And
yes.
so what will happen... What will happen next is that the city will consider the
okay.
budget at its September 20th meeting next week. If they approve it, then that would allow the SAM board to approve the 25%.
Oh, okay. Because the other two approvals are still valid.
They're still
from Montero
just,
and
there still is no commitment on the part of Coastside County Water District to pay for the 25% design.
Mm-hmm.
If Sam does the 25% design and it turns out that this project is not feasible, then the Coastside County Water District is not going to be paying for that
work.
We should move off of this item.
Okay. waiting for fair enough. Okay. Any other meetings that were attended by directors?
It was a short meeting.
That was subtle, Patrick. It was a short meeting. Okay. Then we'll move on to general business, and that's consideration of the October 11th, 2016 regular meeting of the Board of Directors. How do you want to?
We've learned that there may not be a quorum on October 11th. So we have it takes a board action to cancel or change a regular meeting of the board. This is our opportunity to try to do that. We do have some things that we would like to get accomplished at the October meeting. So if there's a way we could move it up by a week, that would...
October 4th?
That would work.
Oh, or
the staff.
Is directors?
I think so. Yeah, I know.
Fourth works for me.
Fourth works for me.
I'm available both days.
You're available. Okay, and I'm available.
I'm the fourth works for me.
So let's cancel the 11th. We need a motion to do that,
yes.
Patrick?
Okay. Yes, you do.
Can we have a motion to cancel the...
You could do a motion to reschedule.
To reschedule.
I make a motion we reschedule our October meeting to Tuesday the 4th at our standard time of 1900 hours.
Sounds good.
Is there a second?
My phone doesn't have 1900 on it.
Oh, I can show you. I second it.
There's a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
Did you second it?
Yes.
Yeah, Rob did.
We have an issue.
Yes.
Oh, right. Our cameraman.
Yeah, our cameraman.
I'll have somebody cover it here.
Okay.
We have a candidate tonight up at Seaton for a couple other agencies.
Well, set your priorities. We're clearly more important.
I thought nobody was running.
Candidates and one at the same time.
Roll call to reschedule.
Yes. Director Coverdell?
Aye.
President Glasper?
Aye. Okay. Moving on to monthly informational reports.
We have no Joe Gustino tonight. If there are any questions about the operations report, I'll make an attempt or get back to you if I can't answer.
Is Denniston off?
No, Denniston is running.
Wow.
You can go through this door here and see 300 GPM every morning when I come in. So, okay, Denniston's at 300 GPM.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Chris would be so thrilled.
Yeah,
Director Feldman, do you have a comment?
Yeah. There was in his report the note that there were 9 water main breaks.
Oh, yeah.
And I noticed, they happen because there's so much, so many miles of water mains. You expect that. I did notice that 2 of them were on Railroad Ave, and 2 of them were on another street. I don't know how in proximity they are. Is there any indication or reason to think? I'm just looking. No, I'm looking for them.
Yeah, that's
for the table. It's in the actual...
In consent,
it's right? In the consent calendar. I gotta go find it. I'm sorry.
Look over the section.
I'm trying to find it. F?
That was south of town.
Huh?
Is it in the street?
It was the service lateral that runs underneath the highway.
There it is. Okay. It was $35K worth of damages and 785 Railroad and Railroad Ave. I don't know where that one was. Both were 2-inch VI pipes. And then there were 2 on Wavecrest Road, 2-inch galvanized. My question is only if there are 2 on the same road and they're the same kind of pipe, is there some meaning to that in terms of this being the start of something good? Or
Wavecrest is really frustrating us because...
Is it going to happen more? Are we going to have more problems with that line and the one on
absolutely.
Railroad? That's all I'm asking.
Wavecrest is really frustrating us because... we have completed we approved it yet? I don't think so. One of the conditions we placed on the new hotel that Cameron Palmer is developing is that he has to run a main down Wavecrest. So, we are expecting that in the very near future that main will get replaced. Meanwhile, you know, meanwhile, we're frustrated that, you know, it's delayed and we have to keep going out there and fixing it.
Okay, so there is a longer-term solution for that based on the new facility there with the main.
Anytime we're getting multiple breaks in one place.
No, no, okay, and Railroad Ave, is there any, anything about that? I mean, it's just...
I'm not really that familiar with the Railroad Ave. I'll get back to you on the Railroad Avenue breaks.
I mean, the others all seem random and different, you know, locations.
Right.
There were two on the same street in two places. Okay, that was my major question.
Anything else?
There's a lot of them. Thank you.
Director agenda items, requests for future board meetings. We didn't set a strategic planning meeting date yet, have we?
We haven't yet. It looks like it would be January or February.
Okay.
Pretty hard to...
I tried, and it wouldn't work for this year.
Okay, so January.
I heard November, and I got anxious about that. Okay, good. Ken?
Oh, that was my question. I think we really need to do it. I think we're well overdue. I really do. I think there are some things we really need to re-up.
I concur.
Would it be the board's preference to do it during the day like we did a few years ago? Schedule a day?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, we're awake then.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other director's agenda items? Hearing none, this meeting is adjourned.
Wow.
In the meantime, we'll bumble on.